thought we had was kind of related to what the other table described, that we generate a lot of pinks, but then it seems to me they're mostly to do with information and communication, whereas if you're going to seriously succeed in devolving the plan-making process from the professionals in town hall down to the community, then there needs to be a process of training and education in how to do it. Yeah. That doesn't exist at the moment. So it seems to me that's a big hole in the existing resources. Call it training, call it education.
But this is training.
Knowing how to do it.
Is this training facilitators or leaders of communities, or is it training? Where's the target?
Well, it could be indirect in that sense, that you train a sort of intermediate cadre of people who then work at a street level or something, or it could be more global and you aim to inform people at a general community level.
So it was that sort of spreading of key information.
Yes, how to do it. How to make a neighbourhood plan. Because unless you do, even though you are doing a certain amount of devolution, then there's a danger that the process actually is dictated by a few pairs of plans.
Yeah, that was the worry last week. It's like how do you work out your whole organisation structure and roles and responsibilities.
Mm. Can I just add to that? That we have that local authorities must remember that they need to do as much, if not more, training in how to listen and understand what people are saying and acknowledge that they're being influenced and act upon that, as much as they're giving the voice to community and the understanding. And I think what's happened, an awful lot of work has been done on community leadership, quite rightfully, but I always think of it as a scales, and if one is out of kilter with the other, but what you're doing is building up real frustration, because people have got the skills to say what they want and demonstrate it in a variety of ways, and you've got it out, and they still can't influence, because then they come across the barrier where people won't listen or put lots of things in the way as obstacles to actually changing that influence. So it's really important, particularly the financial people, legal people, and back room office local authority staff, who, because it's been done that way for 30, 40, 50 years, it's law. Yeah. It has to be done that way, and actually it doesn't. So I do think that's really important. Sorry, I don't want to interrupt again, but I think if there is that notion of giving that sort of level playing field, it's both sides.
And more specifically, Fiona on this table came up with what I thought was a very interesting idea. At stage five, that maybe there's an opportunity here to produce a plan in a very different form from the ones that we have at the moment. Yes, that's right.
Neighbourhood plan in an accessible form, interactive. We had last week someone to us talking about storytelling. The skill, which maybe covers some of this thinking, storytelling that cuts across cultures and languages.
So I think we can get to focus on the plan making, which I can understand, you know, that's what we are talking about today, but it's actually, you know, it could be a total waste of time if it's meaningless at the end. So it's trying to help people either understand what it means for the future of their area, but also, you know, applicants and developers to understand the aspirations of the community and trying to make it real.
Might get communities voting against their own plan through that. It's a quite long process to make both of these. So.
But I mean, that's another reason for storytelling, or certainly even talking about, you know, the gap between when houses are going up to when they were consulted about. It's a huge amount of time. It's almost a generation for some people. And how do you sustain people's interest and stop them plateauing, and what could the work be doing around that?
We also talked about something that last thing we should mention is we were very conscious that lots of the tools we were talking about are sort of individuals talking about their area, but actually how do we involve businesses in the planning process, perhaps as an important part of the community rather than just people sort of as individuals?
As a representative of the business, one of the things that we would consider, I mean, my personal interest, I'm a software monkey professionally, and one of the things we've been doing is using a lot of the data that's become publicly available in the last couple of years, which includes, for example, the entire road network of the UK, all the public transport information for the mainland Great Britain. And last weekend, my partner was overjoyed to hear that I was spending all weekend building a tool to visualise public transport access. If you type in a postcode and how far you're willing to travel and a day and a time, it'll show you a pretty picture. But that is built with Google Maps, so as a business, we would have to give that away free. Google Maps license means that has to be given away free, and we're fine with that because we're never going to, so to speak, filch money out of neighbourhood planning groups. They're not really a viable client base because they're too small, but we want to increase the technical ability of neighbourhood planning groups because we want to make the process evidence driven as well as personality driven and feelings driven. So our plan, bearing in mind that I built it last weekend, would be to host the programme on our website for anyone to, any public body, so any non-profit making body to use, to be able to show access from where they are to where they might want to go. And that's maybe a model that we're, because the plus for us is PR, you know, we get our name around, we get our software used, and that's a bargain we're happy to strike. If someone wants to use our software and thus raises our profile, if we weren't going to get them to pay us anyway, then we may as well let them, you know. So I think there is opportunities for businesses to, if they offer a service already, potentially they could offer it.
And what about more widely? Is it possible for you to speak as a business in your local area, where you're working?
Absolutely.
So, because that's a slightly different model again, because that's where, you know, you're looking at the neighbourhoods, and some neighbourhoods are very business-centric anyway, but most neighbourhoods have some kind of business, you know, it's a corner shop. So
yeah, absolutely.
How do you feel as a business person you might interact with your neighbourhood?
Well, I think we'd be very happy. I mean, we're just up the road, our offices. And I think being involved in local neighbourhood work would be, in terms of this kind of planning process, would be something we'd be very enthused about.
That might be the first place to test out some of your ideas.
Absolutely. Anyway. I mean, the reason we came along is essentially because we wanted to kind of see what people's avenues. I mean, my own interest is technical. I want to kind of know what tools people want, because there's a lot of data out there and I'm interested in helping people access it as such. But yeah, absolutely, being involved and being able to lend some of our expertise into a process.
So that's a model which might happen in a lot of neighbourhoods where there's, you know, different expertise are able to help the whole process. And so that when we're talking about a strategic, it's almost like a skills pool you need at the beginning of the process to say, who's got what, how can we bring this to get to bear in our team going forward, and how do we keep the door open to others that join in the ring and neighbourhood. So that's, you know, then you can say, well, how do you facilitate that skills pool? Because that might be something that the web could also help with. Can we move to the last table?
I was just going to say, coming back to that, and I work for the same organisation as you, the big question to my mind is when that startup phase, which is the training issue, I probably they referred to, it's getting the group, however it's defined, to ask the right questions. I'm sure that as businesses, as individuals, as professionals, we can answer any question about the subject that we're experts in. It's about framing the questions correctly in the first place, so you then can move through the steps in terms of preparing the plan. If you don't phrase pose the correct questions in the beginning. You know, you can say, okay, this is a general question about how does the neighbourhood look, but you've actually got to pose the questions that you need answers to, be it at a technical level, be it at a community level, to be able to move through the process. So I think that the training is everything. The professionals in the room and the neighbourhood can supply the answers, but they've got to be asked the right questions, and I think that's quite important. And building on what Neil was saying, what we're seeing is a big move towards social enterprise. Now, some of our guys, and Neil's one of them, myself, we're looking at actually putting our time in as part of a social enterprise into this planning, into the neighbourhood planning process. So we can actually shape the environment. After all, we live and work in it as well.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that's the way things have got to go. And I think the business collectively has just got to be a little more creative. And Colin's point there about the town hall and the back rooms, I really respect it's going to be very difficult to drag some of those professionals out of the town halls, but there is this sort of intermediary, the sort of advisory services that do look both ways. They do look to the social enterprise, they do look into the public sector. There's a bridge there that needs to be built then.
Can I add to that? Because I mean, I don't know if I've fully understood you, and I suppose you would agree with me, but I don't think that this about, you know, asking the right question. I think sometimes it's more about finding the right answer.
And then working back.
Yeah, because I think there will be a different process. Yeah.
It's also about taking the risk to know nothing or not to understand. Because otherwise you live in the room of plagiarism, the room of reasonable, but actually you also need to live in the room of not knowing. And that goes for all parts of the process. It's easier said than done, you know, because that just feels like a high risk and then people want to pin it down. You know, it's understanding the project.
I suppose the problem you've got, though, you will come up against that examination where you will be picked out.
Well, by that time, you should have that.
Well, yeah.
You don't live in the room and not knowing that. That's too weighty. That's when you go to the room.
Any more from the table?
Yeah, I think one thing I'd like to just highlight, and reflects upon what we saw last week as well, is how the common theme seems to be productivity. And organisation through startup and preparation and part of the examination. But we often seem to peter out as a group through examination, referendum, and adoption and action in our discussion about tools available and tools we might believe in the future as well. I just wonder whether that's worth pausing on, given that the examination and crucially the referendum process could be the very sort of linchpin of that, this entire neighbourhood planning process.
Because it's going to feel like the end for a lot of people.
So if there's a gap in the physical infrastructure. So, considering that we all seem quite comfortable with the starting and preparation process, but less confident about exactly how the referendum process might either go on or be supported.
Which feeds back to me about what expectations you're setting up. Because, you know, there's nothing worse than the post-it note, what do you want, you know, which is completely just, you know, going to get you into the right mess.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, as you said earlier, once you've got into the point when you've got them being looked at by an independent examiner, and then you suddenly realise that a lot of plans are on.
I think what I'm most interested in is making sure that the tools deployed or developed, offered to resident groups in the start of the preparation process are suitable to continue into examination and referendum stages. And if you don't consider that at the early stages, if the groups aren't then able to share the proposals, just in the same way that Joe was describing with the one blue sticker that got there with the accessible form interactive adoption, if the work in the early stages can't be offered in that format, then I think may come under the condition of the work process not be
And I think the big follow-up to that is, as you were saying earlier on, in terms of the action that comes out of it at the end, it may be several years downstream, and I think it's how you keep that enthusiasm alive. Everybody's rushed in to prepare the plan, they've been keen, etc. You've gone through the examination, and that's very clearly a big hurdle to jump. The referendum, once again, is another hurdle to jump through. That's kept everybody's interest. Right. What then happens in 5 or 6 years' time, while it takes the time to build the houses?